anniversary of Shanghai University.
On this special occasion, we have the great pleasure to have had Professor Kurzweil to join us for the celebration. His visit, of course, is a much expected event. Now, please allow me to present our distinguished guests. They are Professor Paul Kurzweil, a world-famous social linguist, fellow of the British Academy from York University, Britain. Professor Liu Changgen, Vice President of Shanghai University.
Professor Wen Qiang,
Dean of the School of Foreign Languages. Professor Li Shuqiong, French School of Foreign Languages. And we have two special guests here. They are Wu Zhuang from Guangdong University of Foreign Studies. Dong Hongjie, a PhD in Renmin University of China, teaches graduates and undergraduates, mostly from the English section. Welcome. Now, let's invite Vice President Liu Changgen to give a welcome speech.
And a heartfelt appreciation for your coming. Shanghai University is a national key university founded on a vision advocate of Chairman Mao, the great founding father of the People's Republic of China. It is a comprehensive university, and now this year it celebrates its 60th anniversary. And among the 2,600 Chinese universities, the ranking of Shanghai University is around 60.
Is a leading scholar in dialectology and dialect contact. He was elected Fellow of the British Academy in 2017, had adjusted their speech after moving to the city. In this work, he identifies two types of coins, regional coin and immigrant coin. And this classification is recognized by most scholars. Professor Kurzweil's later influential projects include a study of the British new town of Milton Keynes and an investigation of multicultural London English. This is the topic today. He's currently developing interests in language and social class, as well as social linguistic issues in West Africa.
Now, Professor Kuswa.
The title of my talk is Multicultural London English, the Future of Violence in Britain, question mark. So the question mark at the end suggests that, well, maybe these new multicultural ways of speaking are the way of the future for English, in Britain at least, and in other parts of the world, London is now coming from other parts of the world. So I'm going to divide my talk up into a few sections, which go like this. So the first one, I'm going to talk about the origins of English, and probably those of you who are English majors know about this already. So this is like a sort of recap, I guess. And then I'm moving quickly on to the 19th and 20th centuries, the traditional dialects. So these are the mainly rural dialects of English, called urban dialects, which were formed during the Industrial Revolution of the 18th and 19th centuries. And this is where the industrialization that has been happening in this country, I guess, for the last 100 years or so, but the industrialization began So we find actually conservatism and continuity. And by conservatism, I mean that dialects basically stay the same, nothing changes. Okay. And then continuity, that means that old features remain in the language for some time. Okay. But there's also, as I said, leveling, which I put here. So there's also a sort of a leveling out of dialects so that they are not as distinct as they were once. And then moving on to the 20th and 21st centuries, we're looking at more dialect leveling, and I'm going to be talking about the city called Milton Keynes, which you mentioned just now. This is research I did some years ago now. And there was a certain amount of innovation at that time as well, but mostly leveling. So this is something probably that you find in this country around the capital city, I would imagine, some sort of leveling. Consulting my linguist colleagues here, I'm looking at them at the moment from here. So some kind of spread of the national language is somehow part of this kind of level. But one thing I think we have to distinguish for English at least is standard English on the one hand and then regional dialects on the other hand. So the regional dialects are moving slowly towards standard English, which is the language that you're studying, many of you. But it's not the same thing as standard English. So you have to think of, not in the south of this country, but in the north of this country, the dialects of Mandarin, which are not quite the same as standard Mandarin. And this again shows my ignorance. I don't know if there's a progression of those varieties of Mandarin in the north of China towards something more standard. But that's the sort of thing that's happening in the UK. It's not like it's the opposite. Okay, going back, right back again to that sort of outlining what I'm going to talk about, I will now talk about it. So the English language, we think of it as starting around about 500 AD, CE, on the era, with migration of people speaking Germanic dialects, Anglo-Saxon, different Anglo-Saxons, about 1,500 years ago. And these, when they came over to England, to Great Britain, merged and became a language that modern scholars called Old English or Anglo-Saxon. Okay. It's a language that none of us, unless we studied it separately, can possibly understand. It's very distinct from the modern English. But one of the interesting things is to see whether the dialect differences of the original migrants, the people who migrated 1500 years ago, if any of those leave any traces in the modern dialects. So, can the differences that existed way back then, 1,200 years ago, still be traced in some way in the modern dialects? I'll return to that as in a few moments. Okay, so this is a map of the Anglo-Saxon invasion, circa 550, and went on for a couple of hundred years. So the question is, I suppose, whether is well, okay, there are some green arrows here. These are constructed arrows. These are not fact in any sense. It would be very hard to trace exactly where these migrations came from. but we assume that it was the northwest of Europe where people were speaking what are now called Germanic languages. Okay. But one thing is quite clear, and that is that the Anglo-Saxons migrated to many different parts of England. They did further south, where it's at Lincoln, I didn't read that from where you're sitting, and they migrated into the south, far south of England as well. Okay. So initially, there is dialect differentiation. That's always been there. Okay, I mentioned dialect continuum. I haven't mentioned it yet, the idea of a continuum of dialects. So what we had way back in Old English times, what we have today, is a continuum of dialects, a dialect continuum. And what is a dialect continuum? Well, you can think of a language X, English, for example, as having a number of varieties. Let's just simply say that there are four varieties of this language, A, B, C, D, and they are arranged geometrically in a way, left to right, north, south, whatever, that is depicted there. So what happens is that each dialect is mutually intelligible to the next dialect, meaning that people from these two places, A and B, can understand each other. That's what mutual intelligibility means. Right. There would be problems, though, with people from A talking to people from C, because the linguistic distance is too great. They don't understand each other. This is familiar to you in China. There are many dialects which are not intelligible to other people's dialects. Is that right?
Yes.
I think you've experienced this yourselves. But then here you have B and C. Well, they are in fact mutually intelligible. Does that happen in China, something like that as well? You have dialects close together, people can understand each other, but people further away can't understand each other. Okay. So it's a very familiar thing across the world, in fact. This is the position that's always existed in England and Britain generally. And I suppose the question is, with dialect levelling, which I'm going to be coming on to in a short time, is whether dialect levelling just removes some of these dialects so that people can understand each other across a much greater geographical space. That's clearly happened in England because people from Yorkshire, where I live in the north of England, understand people from far south of England, the south coast, but it also hasn't stopped. At the same time, some dialects become more different, so the opposite of levelling. And I'm going to be showing you an extreme example of that at the end. Okay, the survey of English dialects is something you probably haven't come across. This was a survey composed of recordings done in the 1950s to 1960s. By a man called Harold Orton at the University of Leeds, which is also in the north of England. What they did was to find a whole network of rural localities, villages, basically, which they assumed spoke the most conservative dialects. So by conservative dialects, we mean, as I said at the beginning, dialects that preserve old features. All right? And the reason for doing that get a baseline of the most traditional conservative dialects of England. Okay. And then they can do comparisons between these dialects. That's the whole point of this. This is a map of the networks here. And you can see each little spot here is one of 300 or so fieldwork localities. Okay. So they went to each of these with a huge long questionnaire. Some of it was tape recorded, some of it was not tape recorded, just written down directly into great big ledgers, books. And so that information, you can access it in printed form. It was printed in the 1970s. It's been digitized, of course, now. You can access it online. I think you have to pay some money, but it's there available to us. And some of the recordings are also available online, though not all of them. So this gave us a picture of traditional dialects in circa 1960, okay, so 50 years ago. I'm going to show you some of the data now, and it says vowels here. Who in this room has studied phonetics of any form at all? Hands up those of you who studied phonetics. is lesson one in phonetics, then, okay, English phonetics. So, we're going to keep this simple, but you, I say hope, are going to see some phonetic symbols. Now, if I managed to use this computer, you would see phonetic symbols. It's possible that with this computer you will not see phonetic symbols, for which I apologize. It's a problem with my computer here. Let's see what happens. I'm really excited. Right, okay, so this is a map, and the this shows the phonetic symbols correctly. I can't guarantee this. So what is this? Okay. It is. The vowel in words like bath, fast, craft. And you will notice my own pronunciation is with an R kind of vowel. Bath, fast, craft. And the symbols of the southern half of the country, the two dots, represent that kind of pronunciation, R. But you see in the top half of the country, you can see the top half of the country there, that there's just an A symbol with no two dots. People in that part of the country say bath, fast, craft. So some of you probably know about this already. This is the basis actually of American English, but the Americans don't say bath, fast, and craft, but they say bath, fast, and craft, as you all know probably. Okay, and that's probably what you're learning, many of you, those of you who learn American style English. So it comes from the north of England, that American pronunciation, but it's not that the American pronunciation isn't quite the same. Okay, this is one thing that, one simple thing, I guess, conservative English dialects found. And this is one that might well be exotic to you, meaning that you probably have no idea. So words like strut, cut, love, they have an up type sound. And that is the sound that you all learned. Every single one of you in this country, in this room, have learned that when learning English. And you see the symbol for that is this one here. That symbol before. Hand up. Those of you come across that symbol. One person in this room has that. Congratulations. Yeah. But you don't believe me, do you? But other people have, I'm sure, as well. Okay. So that's strut, cut, love, etc. Now, in the north of England, where I live, although I'm not a resident from the north, they say strut, cook, love. Now that sounds different, doesn't it? Mud, okay, for mud, right? And that is the dialect that I hear every day in where I live, which is in that top half there. And that is the original pronunciation. So spelt with the letter U, you know these words, like cup, for instance, spelt with the letter U, and that originally is a quote-type sound. In the south of England, people say ah, and that is also the basis of American. So these are things that are, sort of, in a way, quite, in some sense, quite trivial, because we knew this already, okay? But there are lots more complex things. I mean, there are hundreds of different features. I chose just these two features because you already know them, okay? But there are many other features I could have chosen. Okay, let's move to consonants now. So initial H in words like hammer, house. Now, what most English people say is aus and amma, ill and hill. They don't pronounce the H, all right? And I see many disbelieving faces in this room, right? But they don't pronounce the H. Now, what this map shows is an interesting thing, and that is that where the little dots are in the north of England and in the southeast of England, that shows that, in fact, people do pronounce their H's in those places. But everywhere else, including the bit around York, which is illustrated here, don't pronounce the H. As they say, I live in an house, instead of living in a house, an house, they would say. Okay. So that's something that this survey showed. All right. Another thing the survey showed was, and this is one you don't know, word like sing, ring, song. And the way I pronounce it is, the way that you learned. But people in this area on the left sing, ring, song, singing. Don't learn that, don't teach that, right? Because it will mark you out as coming from Liverpool or Birmingham. Anybody know where Liverpool is? Anyone heard of Liverpool? This is the title page of the book. You can see on the right it says Distinct Phonology of English Dialects. This book is actually 900 pages long. I've held a copy of it, it's that thick, right? But it's online, you can download it off the internet, so you can actually read it online, which is what I've done. Not every page, I have to say. But this is something that you'll find really exotic. This is on the left. This is the English, the existing pronunciation of English dialects, 1889, on the left. Where is it saying, I am? Okay, I am. So you can see the little crosses. I'm not sure how well you can see them. These crosses here represent I am, which of course is what we all say, standard English. Right? But it exists in the dialects, in the Midlands, in the East, in the Midlands and the East Coast. In the North, you get this form here, I is. I is. Don't try and teach anybody that. It's I is. And then we have this, the green triangles in the Southwest. I be, a huge area, I be. Now, that is actually West Saxon. Okay, so that feature is 1,500 years old, instead of saying I am or I is here. So this is in the 1880s, data probably from the 1870s. This is the Survey of English Dialects, data from the 1950s and 1960s, 100 years later. And you see, well, exactly the same thing. All right, I have IR, IB, look, there's R there, there's R there, IB. Then we have am, all this area here, central area, I are, then I is, and I am. Okay. So what that shows, and I really do find this quite amazing, is great continuity over 70 years of this non-standard form. Okay, it just doesn't move, right, in that time, 1880 to 1950. But, as you all know, almost nobody uses any of these forms other than I am today. 70 years later, right? It's gone. They've gone. The IB, IS, IR. Not completely gone, but very few people use them now. So this is leveling towards standard, right? This is an example of how ordinary people are speaking much better than English. Okay, traditional dialect. Okay, we'll have a quick look at this. These are some really weird features. It's a more weird features, more logical this time. Weird in the sense that you probably won't have come across them, nor have many English people. So the words like long, for instance, in the north of England, used to be lang, as if it was spelled L-A-N-G. So long is pronounced as lang in the far north, or was. And then the word night, it's a word with GH in the spelling, as in night. What used to be pronounced neat, okay, as if it was an E vowel. And the third one is one we've already talked about, and that is the word hill or hill. Right. So let's have a look at some maps of what the heat spread. This is long. You see lang in the north and long in the south, still surveyed in these dialects. And that's in fact a major dialect boundary. That's in some other features, all right. And then, if you then move on to neat, and to neat and reet, night and right, you find a border a little bit lower down, but it's neat in the north and night in the south. And then in Scotland, which is the bit that sits up here, this country up here is called Scotland, you probably know that, they say necht, necht. A bit like German. Okay. Maybe someone thinks about German. German is Nacht for night. Right? So they traditionally preserve that. Okay. So if you put these features together, this is a map from a book by Peter Trutville, which is a name you've probably heard. And so then he has the heavy line, as you can see there, and a slightly less heavy line, which I've also highlighted here. And then you have various dialect areas, the ones that you can see little circles of there. Now, just take a look at this. That's the same map on the left, traditional dialect areas. On the right, we have the Anglo-Saxon Kindlands, circa 700. This is, again, these are maps from Peter Trumbull here. So, you can see on the left that we have that there's some correspondence between dialects in the middle of the 20th century and way back, 1,500 years ago. All right. So, question is, okay, mid-20th century, is it still like that now, 70 years later? And going to briefly have a look at that. So here are two features you already know about, but and but, but and cup, and but and cup, which you already mentioned, and then bath, ras, and bath, and pass. And then one I haven't mentioned, this is the second vowel in the word coffee. Now I say coffee, an E-type vowel, but many people in the Midlands and North say coffee, the F-type vowel. All right. So let's have a look at those things then. So so here you have these are the boundaries of the cup and the cup, but and but. See, and then this then is one you haven't seen before. These are the boundaries of the what has been called the happy vowel. It's not a nice name, really. Happy vowel. So in other words, if you have an E sound, it's an E variant, E version of the happy vowel. And you have it in the northeast of England, as you can see, and you have it in Liverpool, traditionally, which is on the left there, and you have it all in the south of England. So there are just two places in the north which have it. So that is Liverpool and far north, Newcastle, and then in the south. So these are traditional boundaries. And they still exist to some extent, but the E-type vowel is actually on the increase. That's probably what you all learnt, right, two years ago, when you learned from English, and the Americans use this form as well. Right. So these are the dialect areas again. This is a picture you've seen for the third time now. And then Peter Trutville comes up with much more recent dialect areas. See, a lot fewer areas now. Okay. And this is because of dialect leveling. Things are really level now. And with Trutville, we drew our attention to this really in his textbooks at that time. So what you can actually see is that the Anglo-Saxon features have gone, Anglo-Saxon boundaries are no longer important, in fact. Yeah. It's sort of been erased through the leveling processes. Right, so another feature that, this is one that I did some research on some time ago. Okay, this is the use of th and the for English th sounds in words like thin and father. So, the word thin is with a sound that Chinese people find quite difficult to produce, th, and the word father has the voiced version of that, in the middle, okay? There's a tendency in is as either a firm F or a firm B. Okay. So what I did then was to map out places where the F and the V began to replace the firm and the verb. Okay. And I wrote the date beside each. So you can see that this seems to have started in London. And then the next city that it went to, and this is interesting, London, 1850, Bristol, second city to do this, 1880. Okay, there's evidence that I found that it was happening then. Now, in the city of Reading, where I used to live, I did research on this, and the date is 1950, okay? It was 100 years later than either London or Bristol, even though it's close to both of those cities. And then it spread gradually north to these dates here. Liverpool, absent. Hull, Middlesbrough, Durham, Newcastle, Glasgow, and then in the far north of Scotland. But then if I show you the next listing here, Scott Press, I put, T.H. Bunting, it's called T.H. Bunting, first appeared in Liverpool in a big way in cohorts, that is, you know, it's groups of children born sometime between 1985 and 1995. So it came in actually after I did this research in 2003, okay? By the time those children were, you know, at school. So it's a very recent thing, this thing. This is one way of just seeing how the language changes. This is part of the leveling process, if you like. Okay, now, let's have a look at a town called Milton Keynes. And you'll find out what I mean by this, as you'll see. Okay, there's levelling in Britain. It's the consequence of contact between dialects and migration. I haven't pointed this out. Migration is a really, really central theme to dialect change. Absolutely, probably the most important thing by a long way in explaining dialect change, and I think it has is having big consequences for the Chinese dialects in this country in the last 30 or 50 years. Okay, we have this very big migration from the north to the south in China, and so this is one of the things that Chinese dialectologists, Chinese linguists are interested in and are researching at the moment. So, when there's migration, there's contact between people, okay? So if you move from the north to the south, you meet new people you haven't met before, and they meet you from the north, speaking a dialect or a way of speaking they haven't encountered before. So these two people who meet each other, they speak different dialects for the first time, they accommodate, they converge toward each other a little bit, they become more similar to each other. So that is the basic mechanism of dialect leveling. So what if we look at an extreme case of dialect leveling, or dialect contact, I should say, a new town? I believe China has many new towns, am I right, that have just formed in the last 30, 40 years, something like that. Well, Britain has a handful, maybe 10, 15, something like that. So this new town, called Milton Keynes, was founded in 1967. Okay, so it's just turned 50 years old. Right. And just to show you where it is, there it is. And you can should see London, just to orient you, there's London in here. There's Milton Keynes there. The distance is about 80 kilometres, something like that, between the two places. Now, I'm also going to talk about Reading, which is this place. Which is not a new town. Okay, I'm just going to mention it briefly because we did research on this. But I'm really going to focus on Milton Keynes, and I'm going to focus on the general sound of Milton Keynes. Now, I haven't really got time to go into detail on the phonetics of this, but it's quite complex. But I think what we can do is in a few moments, to listen to an example of Milton Keynes dialect. But let's look at migration and population changes, some of the technical things first. So you can see 1967, at the time time of its founding, there were 60,000 people living in the area now called Merton Keynes. Okay. So this was before the new town. These were people who already lived in smaller towns and villages in the area. Okay. And then by 5 years, 4 years on, you can see that the population has increased a little bit. But then by 1977, it's increased quite a lot. And then you can see 161,000, 197,196,000, 2007, 227,000. It's still increasing today. But the main population increase was really in the 70s and 80s. Okay. So there was a big increase in the population then. Most of it driven by migration. People coming from other parts of England and Scotland. Okay, migrating there. And one other interesting thing is that people who migrate tend not to be 12 years old, they tend not to be 75 years old, they tend to be between, 25 and 35, childbearing age, right? So migrants have a higher birth rate, this is true the world over, higher birth rate than people who are not migrants. So this also has an effect on language, because you have these kids essentially learning the new dialect. Not only learning the new dialect, but creating a new dialect of a new town like Milton Keynes, because of a high birth rate there. Okay. So, so Milton Keynes projects, there were two assumptions behind what we did. And one was that a new dialect is formed by children and not adults. Okay. And the other assumption, which I think I've deleted. Oh no, I haven't. Look, it's there. I thought I deleted it. It's good. This is a good one. The new dialect is spoken by older children, not by younger children. Okay. Because young children live with their living with their parents. Okay. Older children social relations at school with other kids. All right. And they turn away from their parents at a certain stage. So they are the ones who actually speak the dialect. Right. Okay. So I'm now going to play you something, and I hope you can hear this. Now there's I've got a transcript here. So these two girls, Sue and Melissa, born in 1979 in Milton Keynes, recorded when they were 13 years old in 1992. Quite a long time ago now. That's S for Sue, M for Melissa, and an AW, that's Anne Williams, who was the field worker. So you'll hear an old woman's voice as well. So, what I'm going to do now is to see if I can maneuver this. Okay, starting now.
I'm shopping. Yeah, I'm shopping. I bet there's loads of people in this school take drugs, but me and my brother have been nagging my mum and dad because they smoke, and we don't like it because we're past smokers, and then it's just frightening because you think, oh, they might die sooner or something like that. So they've given up 2 weeks yesterday.
My mum and dad used to smoke, but only at parties and that. But now they don't smoke at all because they found out how bad it was. My granddad used to smoke about 100 a day, but he had about 5 heart attacks and that. So he gave up about 5 years ago when he moved down to Costa Rica.
Can you understand that for us? Anyway, but what I notice about that accent is there's not much to notice about that accent. Okay, it's a very middle-of-the-road, ordinary Southern English accent. So if I met that person somewhere, I think somewhere in the south of England, I don't know where, from the south of England, that's it. And what's striking about that is that it is just a general Southern. And that we believe is because it is actually a mixture of accents. England, but probably not London. They don't have broad accents at all. And they have, for instance, they say, they have a few non-standard features. I don't know if you noticed this one. They'll only kill themselves. And that is a very commonly found non-standard feature in English dialects. They also drop their H's from time to time. Heart attacks. But E, E's ad, she said, but she pronounced the H in heart. But hundred of that, she also pronounces the H. So there's some H and some not H there. So it's a bit of a sort of mixed accent. In a few minutes, I'm going to play you something completely different. Okay? But not just yet. Okay. Now, H. Talk a lot about H. And what we find with H is that it gets dropped, traditionally in England, and we saw that map. In the centre of England, it gets dropped in the southeast of England. But, remarkably, in the south of England, H is increasing. It's getting more and more H in the south of England. Okay. So, now, what can we do, show about Milton Keynes and H? Now, that study that I just talked about also included these two towns, Reading, which I've already mentioned, which you've seen that on the map, and Hull, which you haven't seen on the map, which is near York, actually. So this is in the north of England. New York is about where the pointer is now. So Hull is an hour's drive from York. Hull is in Yorkshire, which is a part of the country where people regularly don't pronounce H. Okay? The majority of people don't pronounce H. People come from there. Now, traditionally, the same is true of both Milton Keynes and Reading, that people did not pronounce their H's in both Reading and Milton Keynes. Okay? So we researched that, and also researched the young people. I mean, this is an old study. It's about 25 years old now, this study here. So, what did we do? Well, we looked at the dropping on H, so H-lessness. Okay? There's three age groups and two genders. So the elderly people here, so these were people in all three cities, Milton Keynes, Reading and Hull, people who were in their 70s and 80s at the time of recording, they hardly produced an H at all in the interviews that we did. So we interviewed them and there was no H. Then we did the same thing for younger people in Hull, and look at this, no change. Teenagers, so these are boys and girls, still no age, either the boys or girls. But in the south of England, we see something different. So we see in Reading, which is this one here, boys produce pretty much 50% of H, so half the time they drop the H and half the time they didn't drop the H, produce the H, as in the written form of English. And the girls have a lot of H, okay, 20%. They actually produce 80% H more or less. Okay. So the girls are leaking somehow. What about Milton Keynes? So this is Milton Keynes, elderly people in Milton Keynes who are from before the Newtown. Didn't produce H, but both boys and girls produce a lot of H. Okay? Very little H dropping, which means, of course, a lot of H. And that is the finding here. Okay? So the way we see this is that Milton Keynes, being a new town, high, lots of contact, lots of people moving around. So there's this language change going on, which introduces H into the accent, into the dialect. But it's going faster in the new town of Milton Keynes. And it's going to be faster there than it is in Reading. Now, interestingly, in Reading, you can see a gender difference. Okay? The girls are ahead of the boys in acquiring age, as we can see here. This is the boys, this is the girls. But in Milton Keynes, the change is completed. This is an important sociolinguistic point, actually, which means that if there's a change in any direction, it's often women who are in the lead. In Europe, at least, I think in China too, I expect. So women are in the lead in these changes, not always, a lot of the time. And the boys lag behind. There are all sorts of reasons for that, which we could go into. But then once the change is finished, the gender difference disappears. So the gender difference has gone in male to female. There's no gender distinction in age. So that's what we mean by saying that the Newtown dialect anticipates change in its region, the southeast region. And that's why I show you this map here, the whole of this region here. Okay. And for your information, now that I live in the north of England, in York, and I live for a long time now in the north of England, H is actually on its way in to local speakers there as well. So it's a south to north change. Towards something standard, actually, something like standard English. So this change goes towards standard English, producing H. Do you remember the third to third change? A few maps before. South to north. Well, that was a non-standard feature. So saying fin but fin is a non-standard feature, which is moving from the south to the north. At about the same time as this standard feature is moving from the south to the north. So this shows a really complicated picture. In terms of just everything becoming more the same. Sometimes it's getting the language is becoming more non-standard, and sometimes the language is becoming more standard. So both of these things are happening at exactly the same time. Right, moving on. Moving on to something completely different now. Okay? Multi-ethnic cities, a new type of speech community. And by multi-ethnic, we're dealing with European migration into Europe in the last 70 years, actually, from the 1940s, in the Second World War to the present. And this took place as a result of migration from places which used to be European colonies. So in the case of Britain, it's the Caribbean, it's India, Pakistan, Africa. And in the case of France, it's North Africa, places like Algeria particularly, and it's part of the Caribbean as well, French-speaking Caribbean, but not Southeast Asia or Asia, but also parts of Africa, which again French-speaking. So this is the kind of migration that's going on. Now in your country, migration is internal migration, as far as I've understood. So Chinese people moving from one part of the country to another part of the country. And some of the same characteristics, because there are status differences between the countryside and the urban areas. There are linguistic differences, there are cultural differences across the country. But what I'm talking about in Europe really is migration from outside Europe into Europe. The cities that I'm going to be talking about is London mainly, but I'm also going to mention some other North European capital cities. You'll recognize these as capital cities of Copenhagen, Denmark, Stockholm, that's Sweden, Berlin, Germany, Oslo, Norway, Paris, France. I'm going to know that already. So. What we see here is the rise of something that linguists have called multi-ethnolects. Okay, multi-ethnolects. Another term that's also being used is urban contact dialects. Probably tells you a bit more about what's going on, the term urban. These are dialects with multiple origins. They come from different languages and different dialects. So one of the things we find with these urban contact dialects is that they can push out the original population's dialects. And one thing that we find is that in all of these places is that often a half or more of the population are actually second language speakers of English, French, German. They don't speak English as a first language, they speak it as a second language. Or they don't speak English at all. To create these dialects, you need a high degree of social contact among children and young people, in a very obvious sense. Okay? If there's no contact between people, then there's no dialect change. If there's no contact across languages and across dialects, again, there isn't this kind of dialect change. And a couple of other interesting things. One is that, well, they're both related. Multi-ethnolects are associated with youth identities, okay? With teenagers and young adults up to age 25, okay? Multi-ethnolects are cool in the modern sense. And they're associated with music, especially hip-hop. So hip-hop is one place where the multi-ethnolect becomes, moves from the private domain to the public domain, YouTube, anywhere, you can find these things. Okay. And one of the things, interesting things in with researching multi-ethnolects is what effect does popular culture have in the spread of these new ways of speaking. This is quite an important thing. A lot of people have researched that in Europe. Okay, so these are the two projects that I was involved with in the early 2000s, with Jenny Cheshire, Anne Williams wasn't involved in these projects, but Aidan Culberson, Sue Fox, and Carla. So we did these projects over 6 years. I'm hoping to get funding for a third project now. We started work on it to see what's happened 15 years later. Yes, okay, this is the map of London. I think there are 35 London boroughs, something like that, which have a more or less independent of each other. There are two, which we researched, and I'm only going to talk about one of them. A very great amount of immigration. And it has actually received, that area of London has received immigration over several hundred years, actually, from other countries, which I'll show you in a few minutes. Okay. So roughly half the population here is actually not of English origin and doesn't have English as a first language. Okay, so this summarizes what I've said pretty much, the first bit here. But also, these are people with low incomes. So these are not professional people, doctors and teachers and so on, business people, they're not that kind of person. These are people who are come from poor countries, developing world countries, and making a better life for themselves, essentially. Because they are poor and don't have too much money, they tend to form dense family and neighborhood networks. So they live together, many different ethnicities and languages live in the same areas. Okay. This is how the new language forms, actually. So there's a cross-cutting contact across ethnic groups. Young people are important here. We're talking about teenagers. Remember I mentioned teenagers before? Well, teenagers are extremely important here as well. Right. And I'm going to focus on. So what kind of input did Hackney have? Is Hackney having still? From what kinds of language? Okay. Well, we're talking here about varieties of English. I'm not mentioning the fact that people in Hackney have other languages, like, for instance, Arabic, Swahili, Yoruba, Chinese, Turkish, Spanish, Hindi, Bangladeshi, okay, these languages. What I'm talking about is the kind of English that they speak. So we can start off with Jamaican English, okay. In Jamaica they speak a Creole, but they also have English in Jamaica. So this is one of the main inputs, if you like, early on, from the 1940s. Next, you have ex-colonial Englishes, so West African Englishes, English from Pakistan, Bangladesh, India, Southeast Asia as well. Then we have learner varieties, people who are learning, who don't know any English and are learning English. So they speak English with a foreign accent in an obvious way. And then, of course, there's the London local vernacular. So this is a dialect called Cockney. Who's heard of Cockney in this group? Hands up those who've heard of Cockney. One hand there. A few sprinkled around. Cockney, yes. The traditional London dialect, right? That's all around. Obviously, that's there. And then we have the varieties encountered in school. So, standard English, whatever the teacher speaks, it's going to be some form of standard English with a local accent generally. Okay? And of course, at school, you also hear the language of other kids, which are not standard English as well. So, school is one of the best places for the development of dialects, which is a paradox, but it's true. Okay? And then we have the media, you know, TV, film. And you have social media as well, which are as popular in England as they are in this country. And interestingly, and this is I think a very important point, is that monolingual English speakers, Cockneys basically, have also been exposed to all of these varieties here. That also forms part of their input. So this means that the conditions for the preservation of something like Cockney beginning to go away. That's what I said earlier. You know, it pushes out the old dialects. When you have this proportion of people in Hackney, half of whom don't have English as a first language. Okay, this is one of the effects it has. People are dying to listen to some of this multicultural London English, as it's called, in a few moments. But before we do that, let's have a bit of fun now. Well, not that much fun, but I'll show you some labels. They are pejorative, that is, they are very negatively loaded. Okay. Here are some. Kanach Club from Germany. These are the media that develops these, really. Kebab, not Norse, from Norway. And kebab means kebab, right? And kebab is something that you have associated with countries like Turkey, for instance. Smurfenthal in Netherlands. You're probably too young, most of you, to remember the Smurfs, but they were cartoon characters who spoke in a funny way, you know, with a high-pitched voice, hence Smurf language. This is Dutch for Smurf language. In London, we have Jeff Aiken, a term you've probably never heard before. This is a media term that was invented in about 2005. We know that because we researched it. And it's embedded by the media, nothing to do with us, although we were researching it. So we got associated with this term. And look at this term. Jamaican looks like Jamaican. Right? And then there's fake in there as well. Fake news. Well, we're not talking about fake news here. But this is fake. It's pretend, it's not real Jamaican. Okay? It's fake Jamaican. So it's really, really negative. Right? But these are media terms, all of these. But let's have a look at some other terms. Let's look at what the academics did, okay? So in Germany we have Kiezdeutsch, which means neighborhood or good German. Then in Sweden we have the Rinkeby Svenska, which means Rinkeby Swedish, Rinkeby being part of Stockholm. Straattaal in the Netherlands, which means street language. And then we invented the term multicultural London English, which has become quite widespread, at least in academic discourse and media discourse as well. So we actually invented that term, I'm kind of proud of it. Okay. So, can I ask how much time I have? 20 minutes, I can do it, it's easy. Right. Let's look at migration in London now. Okay. 1500, the population was 50,000 compared to the 7 million that it is today. In 1600 it was 200,000, in 1700 it was half a million. And by that time I think it wasn't the biggest city in Europe, actually, at that time. And in 1700 only, but look at this, 1700 only 15% of Londoners had been born in London. So 85% of people in London were not Londoners in 1700. They were mostly not from other countries, it's true, but they were from the rest of the United Kingdom. Okay? So it's always seen huge amounts of migration. And here's a quote then from 1598. London's population is, by birth, for the most part, a mixture of all counties. By blood, gentlemen, yeomen, and the basest sorts without distinction. Right? So social class distinction is built into it, if you like. But there's a strong awareness of London's being multi-dialect place. This is a picture of a church which was built in 1743 by the French Huguenots. And the Huguenots were a Protestant religious minority who were expelled from France and ended up in London, about 50,000 people came. A bit later on in the 19th century, it became a Wesleyan chapel. So this is another Christian denomination. 1898, it became a Jewish synagogue. And in 1976, it became a Muslim mosque, the main one in London. It seats something like 3,000 people. It doesn't look very big in this picture, but it seats 3,000 people. So this represents the different waves of migration that we see in London. And then, if you then go on, nowadays, the big migration, I mean, there's still migration from those, from the former colonies, the Commonwealth. But also, nowadays, since 2004, a lot of people from Eastern Europe, Poland especially. So there are now something like 1 million people from Poland living in England. And we don't know yet what effect their Polish accent has had on English, but there probably is some kind of effect. Okay, what is the effect historically? Well, we see the introduction of the pronouns they, their, and them in the north of England about 600 years ago. We see the introduction of the present tense S for F in early Middle 400 years ago. So Shakespeare, writing 400 years ago, actually has both S and F in the third person singular. That's probably some of you have already discovered. So there are big changes. The dialect change, dialect contact can lead to quite major changes in the language. Right, we're now moving up to the present day and multicultural London English. There was a big increase in immigration from 1948. So people from the Caribbean, followed by South Asians, India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh. In the 1980s, we have people from West Africa, Somalia, Turkey, South America, North Africa, and also China as well. Long been a big Chinese presence in London. From 2004, as I said, immigration from Eastern Europe, after the Second World War, from around 1945, we find the opposite, and that is the out-migration of people from the areas of London, inner city of London, like Hackney, which had been bombed during the Second World War and were therefore not habitable. So people were moved out of London to suburbs where new housing developments were put up, so mostly social housing, but also private housing. And so that left a gap in the middle of London where there's also new development. And that then is where the migrants lived and still live. Okay. Right. This is happening, and this just tells you something about the ethnic composition. I think this is quite striking. Most of the ethnic diversity in Britain is actually in London and not outside London. And it is in places like Hackney. So if you just take, look at this key here. So red means white people. Green means mixed race people, Asian, black, and others. Asian means East Asia and also South Asia in this context. So England is mostly white, okay? 81-82% of people who are the white could be European too, I guess. But look at Hackney here, okay? So it's only 40% white. And then there's a mixture then of mixed race people, Asian people, black people, and then other. So it's the two biggest groups are white and black. And the blacks are composed of Jamaicans and Africans. Okay. So very, very different ethnic composition. And that's reflected, I mean, it's not important, ethnicity is not important, it's the languages that they bring that are important. Okay. So let's listen. listen to some traditional Cockney now, okay? So this is Joyce, who we recorded in the 2000s. So this is a traditional Cockney accent. You'll probably find it quite easy to understand. Here we go.
I used to work in an insurance office and on the switchboard. And it was the same coming in that year when the post, it was a postman. The adult postman used to come in, his name was Wally. And he used to say, Wally, what's he saying? And describe, he said, I mean, baby face, because he was quite, he had quite a nice face. And we looked at him, so we said, yeah, what's his name? He said, well, we all call him baby face, but his name's Fred. So this Saturday morning, he came in with the post, and we just chatted, and he said to me, would you like a couple of pictures today? Tonight? I said, oh, well. I said, where do you live? He said, Upper Clacton. And I said, well, I live in his van. So he came down to his van and we went to the pictures then. From then on, we were all over there. We were together nearly 40 years. And he was my dear, my first real true boyfriend.
Okay, nice little story there. So that just gives you an impression of.
I used to work in an insurance office.
Right. We're now going to listen to Alex. Okay, so he's a boy born in the late 80s in Fleming Place. And this is how he sounds. Listen to this. And think in terms of, compare this with the Milton Keynes that we heard, the two girls. Alright, so he's roughly the same age as those girls, born about the same time. But in Hackney.
Funny night, Jimmy walked past two folks that I did not know, but they just grabbed me by the hood, swanked me in the alley, and had me at knife point. And I couldn't do nothing. But I said, and they said, where are you from? I said, East London. That's where I'm from. They said, don't be funny, because I was right in a bit of East London. So they said, don't be funny with me like that, because they'll stab me. And I said, I'm not trying to be funny. They said, what area are you from? What part? So I'm from Haggerston, Field. Some hero, thank God. There is some typical hero, Jim. And it's like, if you're short, don't even bother come over because you're just going to get stabbed yourself, lad.
Okay, so it's quite a violent thing he's portraying here. He's trying to big himself up to make him kind of inflate himself, I guess, this young chap. But I could go through his vowel system, I could go through some of the grammatical things he's doing, and they are very different from what the other. Right. Okay. Vowels. All right. Now what on earth have I got here? This is a man who was born in 1918, who we recorded as part of a project at the same time. And these are his vowels. I'm just going to point out four different vowels. And it doesn't matter what each of these lines represents is the diphthongs, the vowels that move. So this is the face A. And what he was saying, more like I, face. That's that vowel. This is the goose vowel, which is interesting. And it sounds something like oo, a bit like what I'm saying. Goose. Nothing special. This is the goat vowel, so I say o. This is received pronunciation, I guess. So he was something like ow, go home, he would say. But go home, go. And this is his foot vowel. So, oh, right. So that's that. That's a Cockney system. This one is a man, young man, similar to the one we just heard. It's not actually the same person, but it's something similar. He says face. Not ice, face, but face. Now you can hear the difference, right? Face doesn't sound like ice. Okay, that's what he's saying. He's saying goose. Move, goose, oo, bit like Chinese, right? Oo, something like that. Not oo, but oo. He says, go. And then Alex was saying, o, but o. Okay? Face and go. Go home, he would say. And the foot valve is put, space 10. Right. So, answers than there are. That's just an illustration of what I'm talking about. Okay, a few grammatical changes. So, things like, they say, they go skating rinks, instead of, they go to skating rinks. They go skating rinks. No preposition to in here. I used to go Stratford-on-Avon, instead of I used to go to Stratford-on-Avon. I used to go to school. This is an interesting one. Let's have a look at this. Let's listen to it, and then you'll try and let's see. Right, listen up. Some people notice that he says, I don't care, it's her personality man's looking at. It's not man as in some person. It's an indefinite pronoun, a bit like German. Is that some of you may... Anybody know German in the room? Anybody know any German? So this is like man, right? And it's used in the same way he said it. It's not anything to do with German, but it's come up spontaneously in multicultural. So this is one of the, this is actually quite common, it's quite stereotyped. We're going to hear some more examples of that in the video. Okay, so have a new quotative, we've already heard this. So for quotatives, we say things like, I said, take it easy. Or, I was like, take it easy. This is a more modern way of youth language, I suppose. But what we heard Alex say is, this is me. This is me, he said, instead of I was like or I said. And that's something that seems to have cropped up. And it seems to be easier for people to learn in a multilingual environment than I'm like or I said. That's our argument anyway. So this is a new feature. Okay, two people's language histories. Dom, age 13, parents Colombian, came to London age 2. Parents didn't speak any English. And he and his younger sister interpret for his parents. 8 minutes, right. So he acquired English at school. Then we have Alex, who we heard from. His mother was German, and he lived with her and his Antiguan Caribbean stepfather. And then he and his brother have lived with his Maltese grandmother. His father is Maltese and Ghanaian. So his father has never lived with them. But he and Alex work together and understands Maltese and speaks a little. Okay, so these are part of input, right? Very complicated family histories we have here. So we have a lot of diversity in children's language backgrounds. We have a lot of diversity in the way children acquire English as young children or maybe as teenagers. Bilingual children have to communicate before they can speak English properly. And there's no local dialect anymore. As a target, this is an important point. And we think of language as being a very flexible thing in circumstances like this. Okay? There isn't standard English in the same way that there might be in some other situations. Okay? And we're now going to talk, and I'll just, to bring to finish off, I'm going to play for you a little bit of British hip-hop, also known as rhyme. The first person to really popularize this was somebody who called himself Dizzy Rascal. But the person you're going to hear a little bit of has called himself Stormzy. And he says, he uses man, he's in it, and he uses all sorts of other slang terms as well. So let's just have a listen now. This is a bit quiet, I'm afraid, but try and follow. I'll indicate when it starts, when the actual song starts.
Shut up. man with a pot and a barrel. Contributor and all, I come from my head to show. To the crowd, I'm cool in my tux. Body standing with a low hole. Got from the building, do you say? To the crowd, with a girl say, hey. Tell them I like, I'm clean to the A. There's no champagne, we don't. Yeah, I'm the best, I'm so cocky. I got a mop like Ace of Rocky. I said, trick, the man cocky. They can't beat me, I can't body. They won't beat, I don't sweat. Got about 25 feet in my posse. They can bring these eyes and trust. I get murky, they get hot. If you got a G8, you bring it out. Most of the room, that place is a
That was quite something. I think you agree. But you couldn't really hear it terribly well, but you could at least read some of it. Okay. And this I think is where I was. This is where I was stopped. I was going to say that it's a style of speaking. I've already said it's cool, associated with youth, and this means that some of its forms can move into the way of speaking of people who are not from these sorts of backgrounds that I'm talking about. Middle class background. So here we have a journalist called Nick Harding, middle class educated man, who has a daughter who is also middle class and goes to a posh school probably. And he complains that the way she speaks sounds as if she's from South London, downtown Los Angeles, and Kingston, Jamaica. Right? So that's this kind of accent just been listening to. But then when the girl talks to her dad, she speaks in received enunciation. And Harding then writes, well, Millie now speaks a version of what academics call multicultural youth English, or MYE, MLA, which is picked up from her friends. And her friends are middle-class girls from the suburbs of London, in her counties. So, really just to conclude, we have this new accent. It's a very much a contact variety of English, meaning it doesn't have the continuity that I was talking about in the beginning. It doesn't have that. Because it has in other languages. Then it's formed by youth, and because it's formed by youth, it has the sort of fashionable aspects that we'll be talking about, and part of that is its involvement in this sort of this kind of grind music, which is fairly sort of subversive and confrontational. Okay. Whether it lasts, whether the influence of this thing is going to last, well, adults who did speak multicultural English in their youth still have many of the phonetic features, and they can slip into it when they want to. So it's more or less, for some people at least, it's more or less permanent. But it's very much part of the London, or the English dialect scene these days of London. And so that is my answer to the title slide. Yeah, that it is part of the future of British English. Thank you very much.
Okay, and we take two questions
from the audience.
Chinese people, but by people in England, in terms of education, really. So the question is whether schools serve to homogenize dialects, to make dialects more the same. Yes. Schools have two linguistic functions. One is the official one, and that is to teach people literacy, read and write correctly. Speech to some extent, although speech is not something that's particularly talked about in English classrooms. But it does make young people acquainted with standard forms of speech. So that's a sort of overt educational side. The other side is the playground. The playground, right? Where there's no monitoring of how people speak. And if you have a new community like these communities we're talking about here, where you go to inner London schools and you hear the teachers at primary school, they report, well, we have 35 languages in our school. And so another teacher would say, yeah, but we have 40 languages in our school. And that's copying, that is the situation right across London and some other parts of England as well. So, now those children, they have to learn English. They have, unless they're going to communicate only with people who speak their own language, they have to learn English. And this is one of the places where, at least in the sort of research we're doing, this is one of the places where we assume multicultural London English grows up initially, at least, okay, until it then leaves the school and becomes part of general culture. In terms of the earlier part of my talk, when you have people beginning learning to produce F instead of F, this non-standard feature, this is not really to do with multiculturalism, it's to do with migration. So you would have in a school anywhere in England people from 10 or 15 different parts of the country. In more mobile parts of the country, the big cities particularly. And so you get dialect levelling going on in that school. This is not something that anybody comments on, it just happens. Okay? And so those children leave school and they then become part of the general dialect. So that is one of the things that drives dialect levelling. And it's not the youngest children, it's slightly older children who do that. That's our assumption. I don't know if that answers your question. Okay. Gentleman at the back, yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Pursley. So can you hear me over here?
Yes, I can, yes.
All right, so my question is, well, at first, thank you very much for your wonderful lecture, which you have showed us the changes or development of the English dialects in the United Kingdom. So, also, such situation also happens in China, and exactly in this province you are now visiting, you know, this province has like about thousands of dialects.
Yes.
And a TV celebrity called Wang Han from this province has started a campaign called Save the Dialect. And also many celebrities has also joined this campaign called Save the Dialect. And I would like to ask you from the perspective as a sociolinguist, do you think such campaign is against the natural evolution of language or for the nature, natural evolution of language?
Did you say national or natural?
Natural.
Natural.
Natural evolution.
Natural. Okay, yeah. Language is never isolated from the community in which it exists. I think we agree on that. And one of the things that affects language is ideology, language ideology, the belief system of the population, and also the belief system of the powerful people within the community, within a society. Now, so I can take a country like ours, like Britain, and there is a strong belief, actually, that standard English is the only correct form, and that dialects are incorrect. Dialects can be good fun, you know, you can have dialect phrases, you can buy a dictionary of Yorkshire English, but it's only for fun, it's not serious, all right? You can study this kind of thing, people do, but it tells you something about the ideology that actually dialects are not, they're not important. Now, in some countries, and one country that I know very well is Norway, in Northern Europe, where dialects are celebrated all the time. And this will surprise you. In Norway, there was a law that's in force that says says that the language of the classroom shall be the pupil's own dialect. Think about that. The language of the classroom should be the pupil's own dialect, and the teacher has to accommodate to the pupils. That is completely the opposite of England and, I guess, China as well. That law was passed in 1871. Okay, so 150 years ago. Now, in England, we don't have that. So the ideology is that we have to promote standard-form speaking, we mustn't have slang, and youth language is particularly bad, okay, regarding as in English. Now, what you see in China, the thing you're just talking about now, is something that you find across Europe, and including Britain, actually, and that is a celebration of the local things. And that inevitably comes up against ideologies which say that actually we need something. That's why I ask you, if you say national or natural, something at a higher global, national level, and that applies in any nation state. So there's a conflict there. That's a conflict you see being played out right now. And it plays out in different ways. It even plays out in Norway, where people celebrate dialects, because there are good dialects and bad dialects. Bad dialects are city dialects, and good dialects are rural dialects. So I would guess, you know, so in terms of naturalness, well, it's, you know, ideology is a natural thing of human societies and belief systems. And language fits into that. So yes, it's natural. That's, I think that would be my message.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for the questions, and thank Professor Criswell for the elaboration. As we have another session, so we have to stop here, and I'm supposed to say a few words as a conclusion. This is a very informative talk. Personally, I specialize in generative grammar, and I'm never minded, I don't have much knowledge in social linguistics, but I'm really impressed by this topic and by this talk. What is multicultural language English? I think we can understand it this way. First, it is a dialect. It is a dialect of English spoken in London, with distinguished features, phonological features, morphological features, and syntactic features, and with marked Jamaican influences. And it is spoken by working class, mainly by young people. So we come to know that it is the first time the English language in the UK has been changed nationally by the teenage group through youth and through grand music. This is the first. Secondly, I think multicultural learning English is a multi-ethnic act. So the speakers come from a wide variety of ethnic and cultural backgrounds, and they live in diverse inner city neighborhoods, such as Hackney, right? I think you mentioned in the talk. I think this has to do with the ethno-linguistic vitality. I'm not sure whether I'm right or not. And certainly, I think we can take it as a variety of English language. Why? Because as we can see, it has the roots in many different languages, West India and South African languages, right? So it's a mixture of languages. Okay, so this talk and this research is really impressive. When we look at multicultural learning English specifically, it is a dialect. But when we look at it in a more general way, initial variety of the English language. No matter which, I think what counts most is when we look at, when we study specific language or specific dialect, we should look at the whole picture. We should keep in mind the whole picture of the language situation. We should have the whole story of the world languages. And this should be the way and try to look for the underlying mechanism, the underlying. I think this should be the way we approach to language study, whether in theoretical linguistics or applied linguistics. And thank Professor Kurzweil for the wonderful speech. Thank the audience. Thank you.